Okay, and welcome back to the MCM game stage. This is a really special session that we've got. We have got three of the actors from Assassin's Creed Syndicate going to be coming up, talking about their experiences. While that happens, Rick here is going to be playing the game, so we can chat about that. So let's welcome them up onto the stage. It's Paul, Jazz, and Chris. Have a seat, mate. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
I like them.
That's me. If you sit next to Rick, that'll work.
So that we're separate, okay. Aren't we?
Is this working? It's working.
All right, well, welcome, hello. All of you.
Hey, Rick.
Hello,
nice
hello.
You, mate. How are you going?
So, like, before we get into it, how, like, used to the con experience are you, Comic-Cons? Like, are you well-versed now?
This is my first time.
Is it really?
This is my first time.
Popping his cherry.
He's popping my cherry.
Con for the very first time.
Feels so good.
Good afternoon, all.
And so how are you finding it? You enjoying it?
Is
it painful?
A little sore. No, I'm
Did
kidding.
Did you get rogered? Have you been rogered? I just learned that what rogered means. I had no idea.
What does roger mean?
It's nice that you've been teaching him the important stuff.
Calls himself a Brit this
week. Well, rogering, we discovered that Roger...
Well, yeah.
Well, he must have done naughty things to people.
Yeah,
that one
right.
Guy in the village is like the only gay in the village. Roger must have been the guy in the village that did naughty things to people.
That's a good point.
And so he rogered people. So, oh, you got rogered, did you?
All right.
Yeah. So one knows what Roger does.
Sorry. From that, if you could go in order and just introduce yourselves, say who you play in the game, and a little bit of your personal background, how you got into acting.
Well, my name's Paul Amos, and I play Jacob Fry in Assassin's Creed. And I'm a classically trained actor. I went to Lambda, London Academy of Music and Dramatic Arts, did 3 years there, then did a ton of theater for the RSC, National, a bunch of stuff, toured everywhere. And then I moved to Canada, where Ubisoft have one of their major studios. And I did TV and film for a long time. I was in a show called Lost Girl. And then last year, I was lucky enough to get this job because I'd always wanted to do a video game. And yeah, you know, I traveled around the world to try and get this job and got it. And spent the year of my life last year making and promoting Assassin's Creed Syndicate.
Beautiful.
So that's who
okay.
I am.
And you?
I'm Jazz Dill, and I play Henry Green in the game. And I'm not classically trained like Paul here, but I've kind of was very lucky and went from job to job in terms of theatre. And then, one day I just got a call from my agent saying that they're casting this game. They were top secret about it, but when I read the sides and started talking about the Shroud, I knew exactly what this game was.
Oh, wait, so you know the backstory? You
I
know
do,
all that
a little
stuff.
Bit, a little bit, yeah.
Okay.
And I remember walking into audition, and I was like, guys, is this Assassin's Creed? They went, no.
Wait, they don't tell you what you're auditioning for?
No, well, they gave me some sides, and being the actor I am, I just wanted to just know what are these things they're talking about, and they talked about the Shroud and, you know, Templars, and I thought, hold on, this isn't Assassin's Creed, is it? And then literally... It was a dream come true to get the job and go out there and have an amazing time with Paul, Chris, Victoria. It was a lot of fun.
And I actually had no idea what the game was.
I had to educate him.
The code name for this project was called Albert. And I had no idea what it was when it came through. I was like, who's going to call their project Albert?
Probably
no,
like
I don't think I
want to
do this. And they were
something.
Like, no, you really want to. We got told it's an amazing project. I was like, all right, I'll give it a look. And as I was doing it, I was like, this is Assassin's Creed.
Yeah, amazing.
And what about you, Chris?
Hi, I'm Chris Holden Reed. I'm a Canadian actor. How I got into acting is a long, long sorted story that has no place in a video game forum.
All right, you can tell me that later.
Yeah, I'll tell you later. But Paul and I had worked together for 6 years on a show called Lost Girl. And I'd been on the Tudors as well, so they were looking for Canadians who could do a good British accent for this. And these guys actually auditioned for this, and they went through like the fire and the gauntlet. And I was lucky enough to just get recommended by Paul. And I had to do a little audition, mind it wasn't like just a given to me. But I got to play Crawford Starrick, who is the big bad guy that you have to kill at the end and likes to monologue about tea.
I'll always remember there's an anecdote about when they were making Planet of the Apes, and they said at lunchtime, everybody's in their outfit, and at lunchtime they all go to like the cafeteria area, and for whatever reason, even though they're all strangers, all of the orangutans sat next to each other, and all the chimps sat next to each other in like little groups. The bad guys sat over here, and the good guys are here. Is this the, like, any kind of personal enmity? Is that what's going on?
That's exactly it. That's right. They smell funny, is the truth.
Oh, fair enough.
We smell funny. Not kidding. Not joking.
All right, so we got a big game here.
Job?
And you were like, you kind of, are you, have you got much of a history with games? Like, in general?
No, I'd never done a game before. I was aware of video gaming. I've always wanted to be in a video game. I had the Spectrum 48K, and then I went up Commodore, Amiga, Sega, Mega Drive, PlayStation 1, 2, 3. And then, I'd always played video games. And then I had a child, so my missus made me kick the PS3 out of the house because apparently changing shitty diapers is more important than stabbing people to death. But fortunately, when I got this job, I was able to buy a PS4 because it was a tax write-off, which everybody on the stage and over there knows that if you're in this industry, you can write your PS4 off to taxes. So I'd always wanted to be in one. And I actually actively sort of pursued it. So I'd asked my agent to really keep their ear to the ground if there was anything happening. And of course, this Project Albert, they said that they heard about it, and it was an Ubisoft project, and it was quite a big project. So I decided that I was like, yes, get me in, let me try and get it. So I got the TGF, which, if you don't know, is an industry term for what is similar in TV to the pilot. So you basically go into the mocap studio for about a week, and you put together a little 10-15 minute slot, which they then have to show to Ubisoft in Paris, and they go, okay, this is what we think the game could be and what it could look like. So I had no idea what the timelines and everything were for this. This is like 2013 and December. So then I didn't hear anything really. And then I'd heard that the project had changed creative hands, which happens a lot, apparently, of these things. And then they changed the director. So he wanted me to come in and do a couple of voiceover things, so I did that. And then I didn't hear anything. And I was like, well, I must have been shit at that. And then, and then in the summer, I heard they were auditioning for it. And I was like, wow, I'm not even getting asked to audition for it. And then they called me in for the smallest, shittiest part on this project. And I was like, wow, I must have been really shit. and I didn't get that part. And then I was like, wow, what did I do wrong? I really wanted to do a video game. And then it was late summer, and I got a phone call, and it literally was like 10 p.m. in the evening. And they were like, the director has asked for you. He wants to know why you haven't been brought in for the assassin. And he's leaving tomorrow at like 10 a.m. So can you come in here first thing tomorrow morning? And we're going to send you some sides. So they send me like 12 pages. And, I'm the sort of actor that likes to learn my lines to go into the audition. So I learned the 12 pages. I got in. I did the three scenes first thing in the morning. And, Ramiro was like, amazing job, man. Amazing job. I was like, fuck, got this job. It's mine. I'm the assassin. I didn't hear anything.
Wow.
Nothing. And I thought, all right, I'm obviously not going to do a video game. So we finished up season 5 of Lost Girl. We finished our show all together. I went to Mexico on holidays. And I'm in deep Mexico. And I get a call. And they're like, we want you to audition for the part again, but we need to fly you to London, UK, and we need you to do it in like tomorrow. So I have to cut my family holiday short. I have to take 3 flights to get back to Toronto, to get a flight to get to London. So I arrive in London, and they're flying me there, right? So you're like, at this point, most people think you got the part, or you're pretty close. So I fly all the way to London, get in, walk in the room, and there's loads of guys. And I'm like, you gotta be kidding me. So I do my 15-minute audition. I go back to the hotel. I fly back to Toronto, and I'm like, well, I don't think I've got this part. I wake up the next morning, I get a call. Oh yeah, it didn't work out with the person that you were auditioning with, so we want you to fly to LA in 2 hours. And I'm like, you are fucking kidding me, right? I've got a life. But I'm like, yeah, I really want to do a video game, so I'm going to fly to LA in 2 hours. So I fly to LA, I get in at midnight, I wake up the next morning, go into my audition, I'm thinking, they're flying me to LA, I got the gig, right? I must have the gig at this point. And I walk in the room, and there's guys. And I'm like, is somebody taking the piss right now? And are they filming this? So I do my half an hour audition, I turn right back around, get on a flight, get back to Toronto, because I'm going to a con in Winnipeg, and it's the only way you can get there. Wake up at 6 in the morning, fly to Winnipeg, do a con, fly back the Sunday evening, wake up Monday morning, and there's an email waiting for me that's like, you are the guy. And that is how I got the job. And that's my experience in video gaming.
That's beautiful, thank you very much. Whereas you just kind of, you were recommended and you didn't have to go.
Paul said, hey, I know this guy. And Miro, yeah, they just, I was actually in LA at the time, and I did the old iPhone audition, put it up, and they gave me the sides. It was also for Albert. And I don't think I had to monologue the T bit, but it was very... But you know what? The thing about playing these characters in these video games is the style of acting is very much like a mix between theater and film, because they're not actually using you. So it was really fun to experiment with being like, okay, well, I'm going to be this big, brooding guy, and you know, you can be more than you would usually be able to, you know, capable of doing with just your own face. So it was really fun to like figure out how to do a Starak, and then lucky enough got the part.
What do they do? Tell me a little bit more about what they do to prepare you for the role. So obviously you've got the script, but presumably they present you with concept art. Do you see some kind of early prototype of the game?
Yeah. From my perspective, which might be a bit different to these two guys. I mean, because you're playing the assassin, and it's the franchise lead. And in this particular case, there was the twins. So, which was kind of unique to this. And to try and create that, we did quite a lot. We went to Ubisoft studio quite a bit. We met everybody. We got the whole range of all of the concept art. And, you know, it's incredible because Quebec City did this and not Montreal. So it switched hands. And I went into the Quebec City studio, and it's 6 levels, and every they have like 350 people working in this building. And I walk into the first floor, the concept art floor, and literally there is not a centimeter or millimeter of space on the wall that doesn't have a piece of concept art, some kind of image of the world, of the character. And it was just amazing. It was just like walking into Victorian England. It was just so immersive. And these people, they're just working in this space, and everyone's playing the game. It's just the whole world is there. And that was my first like walk through the door. And I was like, all right, I'm entering a world that is incredibly detailed, incredibly immersive, dense. And you could tell that people really loved and cared about it. So when we went into preparing for the role, we had a full week of being able to sit down with the whole script, and it was changing quite a lot, quite dramatically, as we were doing it. Because when you're doing a video game, they say it's like this. It's like you're building an aeroplane while you're in the air, because you have no idea if it's going to work. You know, you're putting all the pieces together at this point. So we did loads of stuff. We like walked around the room for, you know, half a day in the characters, trying to embody like the eagle vision and, you know, very much, you know, the physicality of what it is to be twins and an assassin at the same time. So yeah, we did quite a lot of immersive stuff, which really helped us and prepared us for the roles. What about you guys?
I think they were busy with you guys, prepping you guys. So I took the initiative and did my own research. So I didn't get the entire script. I kind of got maybe a little bits and bobs here and there. But I was really interested in just figuring out the character's biography. Where was he from? So I went on a whole kind of history journey of the character's background, what was happening at the time, you know, Indian history, what was going on, Victorian history, really trying to, because I know that having seen a couple of videos of actors doing mocap, I realized that it was going to be very theatrical, as Chris said, that you had to really imagine the environment your character is in. So I really kind of went on a journey of just trying to understand the circumstances of what Victorian era would, what was Victorian London like, where was he from, what was Indian history like, and also assassin history. So I read a lot of the comics, I played some of the old games again, just to kind of really get the feel of it and the taste of this world that we were going to go into. And then, yeah, and just do all that research, meet with Paul, act with Victoria and everyone else, and just see what happens and just make magic.
Yeah, you know, I figured, you know, just like these guys talking about the research, I didn't bathe for about 3 or 4 weeks just to get that good ripe smell going on. I went out and got syphilis. I thought that would be important for Crawford, you know, a little crazy madness going on in the background. I had to play piano, which was fun, and sing. I don't know if you guys have played the game. Who here has played the game? Who here has killed me? Quite a lot of you. Who here really enjoyed it? All right. Good, thank you. But yeah, it was just a really fun experience for me doing the... Go ahead.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, I mean, like Paul, I'd never done a video game, but I grew up playing video games. Like, I was that kid, I'm an only child, and I had the Commodore 64, you know, playing TSR games, Pool of Radiance, and... So when this opportunity came up, I jumped at it, and it was really lovely to find out how fun it is to actually make these games, because people are they're so into it, they're so passionate about it, and yeah, it's an amazing world that you're building. But when you're actually doing it as the actor, you're wearing pajamas with glowy balls on them, and it's really hard to imagine yourself as like a big, powerful mob boss when you're wearing stinky PJs and Velcroed glowy balls on yourself.
Yeah.
So you have to really create the world in your head. Yeah. Plus, you're doing it in something they call the volume, which is a big empty room with about 1,000 infrared cameras around you, and nothing else. Like, they'll build a table for you out of like wood. The props are just immediately made for you, and so it's really up to the actor's imagination to like fill it.
It's like being in a big padded cell, to be honest. And you know, in motion capture, it took us about 4 months to film everything within the game. Because we did pretty much everything, and particularly, you know, Victoria and I, when you're pressing XXX to get it, that's me doing that, and we would have to do it. There would be like a wooden kind of circle thing, and I'd have to go up, and we did this thing called game pose as well, which, if you're an actor, was really weird, because you would do a scene, and you're acting, yeah, and you're trying to get in the part, and you're in it or whatever, and at the end of it, you have to go to game pose, which is the weirdest thing. So you're like, yeah, no, yeah. Absolutely. It was just the strangest thing to do. But acting in that sort of space was, and for these characters, was really interesting with the motion capture process.
There it is right there. That's what he's doing.
Yeah, there he is. There he is.
I remember that day.
And for my perspective, because I'd never done motion capture before, and I did do a lot of research. I watched a lot of Troy stuff. The Last of Us, there's a lot of that footage. And I felt The Last of Us was like probably one of the great games. And for actors' perspective, the cutscenes they're incredible, and the work that they've done in motion capture on that was incredible. But to be an assassin, we actually had boots. I asked for boots that were rigged, because most motion capture people, you're in trainers, yeah, sneakers. So it looks like you're going for a morning jog, but you're an assassin. So we asked for some boots to be rigged, especially. We try to get a little bit of weights into the costume somewhat, so that you could have that sense of Victorian England of the costume. Which, if there's any cosplayers here, like, it's heavy, yeah, it's leather, it's big. It would have been raining. It would have been stinky. So we have to try and get a sense of that in this world where you're wearing leotards, you know. So it's not easy, but it is so much fun.
So much fun. I mean, it really, like Chris said, It really gives you a chance as the actor, as the performer, to really utilize your imagination and really step into those shoes and actually be a part of this amazing narrative that, you know, Ubisoft has created, which is fantastic. I mean, when I got the job and I told my friends, they went crazy. Yeah, when it was great, because I played Assassin's Creed, but I grew up with Halo, so I'm a big Halo fan. So
I'd never had.
Oh yeah. My god, so many memories. Multiplayer.
I don't think I'd ever had so many aunties call my house asking for autographs for their nephews. Oh. It was like a constant ring of like Auntie Bev, Auntie Susan, Auntie whatever. It's like a lot of nephews.
Auntie this, Auntie that.
I'm getting back to the process. With regards to the voice of the character itself, is that something that you nail pretty quickly? Or was there like a whole core Blimey Governor sequence that you went through to find the right voice? Do you know what I mean?
Well, like I said earlier, I'm classically trained, so this really wasn't difficult for me. No, it was actually. You know what? It was really difficult. And actually, I'll tell you a story. When we auditioned for this, it was it felt like a very different character. And because it was more like they were a bit rougher, and they were, okay. You know, they're a bit more. It was a bit more fucky. It was. I'm sorry, I swore F bomb. Sorry. It was a bit deeper, and it was a bit more street. But then they made the decision to have the assassins come from outside, from a more educated class of assassin brotherhood, and then that meant that the accent needed to change. But what I did do in the game. And there's a reason why, but can I tell a reason? Am I allowed to? I'm trying to think of the Ubisoft snipers up there. Well, what happens when you do a video game is that decisions get made on marketing really early on, because these games are like in the process for like 3 years, yeah? So they make a decision to market a particular Jacob Fry that was a bit more like you get in the commercials and the adverts that you get, which is, you know, London, 1868. You know, it's a bit more like that. But the actual character that we were creating in the game was very different. So I had marketing Jacob, and I had game Jacob. And it was a really, it was a little off-putting at times, but what I did to try and bridge that gap was that we decided that the assassins would assimilate themselves given the situation that they needed to. So when he is in the Maxwell Roth situation and it does get more street and it gets more dirty, then I applied the marketing Jacob voice to that. And I was just trying to do the fact that if you were trying to complete a mission, much like in 007 or like a real assassin kind of secret agent type of style, you might assimilate yourself more given the environment that you're in. So, yeah, we did a lot of stuff like that with voice and to try and make it work. I mean, it's subtle, but, yeah.
I guess, I really try to make this accent very specific, and specific in the sense that...
Good job, Rick. Good job, Rick. You're killing it, mate.
Doing amazing.
Is this your job? This is your job.
Is this your job?
This is what you
this
do.
This is your job.
This is Rick's job. Doesn't everybody want Rick's job?
So yeah, no, I mean, there's India has so many different kinds of accents. I mean, if you go from the north to the south, there's so many different types. But there's also something even more specific than that, which is, you know, India was ruled by Britain. So you had at that period of time where Assassin's Creed is set, you had a very, you know, the Indians were being educated, so they learned a very specific kind of accent from their rulers, which was a colonial accent, which I try to go for. So if you have a, you know.
Who is that? Is that Bell or Darwin?
That is Julian Richlings, who plays Death on Supernatural.
No. I mean, like, who's the bloody character?
Oh, that's Darwin.
No.
Jesus Christ. All right. So
oh, yeah,
Darwin.
You're right. It
so
might,
you
must
got
be
to,
Darwin.
You got to, wow. Would you talk a little, like,
it's the
evolutionary
Darwin
philosophy there? Is that important to the Assassin's arc? A little evolutionary philosophy?
Assassin's Creed, they always bring in historical characters that in every single game. Have you played
Very
any of them,
cool.
Chris? Did you do any research for this role? Why did I recommend you?
You gave me the role.
Did you drink tea?
I didn't. No, I knew that Bell was in it. Like I was in a group, but I didn't realize you had run-ins with Darwin.
Dickens, Darwin, Florence Nightingale. Yeah, they were all there.
One of the things that fascinates me about voice acting is, especially for games, is that you spend a very long time being given directions like, okay, now I want a noise that sounds like you've been stabbed in the eye with a stick.
Oh, no.
Now I want a noise like, but it's a bigger stick now. Do the noise for that. Tell us a little bit about that process, because I always find it fascinating.
It's horrific. It is, because you have to do it for, well, it depends how quick you are, but you go into the booth, and there's a slight distinction. I don't know. It irks me a little when it's voice acting, because, I mean, for a majority of this, this was full motion capture. So, like, the stuff I did in the booth was really minimal to, like, what I do in the game. So everything is caught in the moment.
Right.
So the booth stuff was really just the Onos. And the Onos are a pain in the ass, because you go in for 3 hours and you have to do every level of and you have to do it for 3 hours straight with no break, practically. And by the end of it, your voice it sounds like mine. It's like you've just done, you know, you've just been on 3 all-night benders. And it's not a good situation. And, you know, if you have an audition at the end of it, it can be tough. You're like, oh, now I've got to go for a project where I really need my voice, and I've just destroyed it through doing Onos for 3 hours. But it's painful. A lot of lemon and iced tea.
But it's pretty fun. I mean, like, for me, it was, you got to see how the every computer game that I've ever played, how it got, like, broken down, the little sound effects. So, yeah, it's like literally like, okay, you've been punched in the stomach, lightly. You've been punched harder. Now, you know, it's like they break it down into every sort of level of punch that, or hit, or you're giving and taking.
Yeah, swinging swords, dying.
Yeah, it's.
I was just amazed at how specific they wanted those sounds.
Right.
Like you hit lightly, now you hit badly, now you hit lightly, but it's raining as well. You know, it was great.
And it's really specific, and they know what they're looking for, and it sometimes takes a while to get exactly what they're looking for.
Now you're getting hit in the stomach, but you have really bad gas. Now you're getting hit in the stomach, and you have dysentery. And they want to hear the different kind of sounds.
Is there one noise that you have to do that particularly wrecks your throat? Is there a worst one?
It's the big death.
It's the
scene.
Big death.
Yeah,
okay. Yes. It's the you've been drawn and quartered, but the horse by ponies. So it's like really slow and just. Just keep going.
What do you do?
That woke me up. Did it wake you guys up?
What do you do?
I mean, if you've had a bad day, it's great. Yeah. Get to exercise a lot.
To protect your voice?
Yeah, because that's your instrument.
There's nothing you can do.
No,
it's because they want pure expression, and when you're doing it, there's nothing you do. You just drink a lot of lemon and honey.
Hot toddies. That's how I repair my voice.
Yeah.
So, I'm right in saying I believe that you did all of the motion capture stuff, but the combat and the acrobatic stuff that wasn't you. Tell me where the line is.
I wanted to do it all, but insurance purposes means you can't. No, I wanted to do more than we could have.
Right.
But they can't for insurance. So, just for the actors, I mean, if you've gone all that flying a guy around all that time, and then you do it and you break your ankle or something.
But some of it we're just not trained to do. Like,
we're not.
Like when you've got a guy that's jumping on a trampoline and doing a triple flip in the air and landing in like crouch pose.
You could have done that.
I know you're classically trained and all, but.
Well, related to that, you did the assault course. Did you know? There's a nice anecdote there about the assault course that they had at Comic-Con last year.
Yeah, Victoria Fry, she is that character. Victoria Atkin, she's a really competitive young lady. I mean, she's a wonderful, wonderful human being. She does an amazing job in this, but she's really competitive. And we had a whole kind of thing going throughout the whole mocap session of 4 months. I was always like, yeah, but you're only going to be playable for like 34.5 of the game. And, you know, we had all this sort of stuff going on. So we're in Comic-Con and we do the big panel. So, you know, it's like 3,000 AC fans in the room. And they directed this American Ninja course where it was like a parkour course. And it was amazing. It cost like $750,000. It was right on the strip in San Diego. It was incredible. So she called me out on the panel to race me and time me in the morning after. Now I'm thinking, you know, I'm probably going to be hungover at that point, but I've got to do it. So of course I get there a little early. I don't drink as much the night before. I'm visualizing the course of the night before, because I do not want to lose to Victoria Atkin, because she would never let me get away with it. So I'm there. Victoria shows up. I'm doing my courses. I'm trying to stretch, and then all of a sudden someone goes, "You're next." And I'm like, "Okay. I guess I'm ready." Now at the beginning of the course is like a really steep incline. There's the adult version, and then there's an easy version. So I've got to do the hard version. So I'm like, okay, I've got to do this. If I get past this first one, I'm going to be good. I'm going to beat Victoria. So there, 3, 2, 1, I go. And I run so hard at this wall that when I hit it, I pull my hamstring straight off the bat. And I can feel it. And I grab up on the wall, but I pull myself up and I go, keep going, Paul, keep going. You can't lose to Victoria Atkin. So I get through it, I go through the course, I get to the end, I hit the button, bam! Woo! Did it. Subi soft person comes up and goes, "Paul, what you doing?" And I was like, "Well, I just did it. I just did my time, didn't I?" And they're like, "No, man, we're going to do it now." And I'm like, "Wait, what you mean we're going to do it now?" And they're like, no, with the cameras already, we're going to do it now. So I'm like, "I can't. I got a gammy leg. There's no way. I can't do it. You can't film this." And I say, "Victoria, you need to give me 5 minutes." She's like, "No way, you're going first." So I have to do this thing. I'm sweating, literally. I'm in pain, I'm sweating. They're taking pictures of me. It looks like I'm terrified to do the bloody thing. So I get at the beginning, and I'm like, okay, I've got to do it. So I do it, and I don't know what happened, but I must have had so much adrenaline running through my body that I did that course, and I set the course record for the weekend. Boom. And I beat Victoria Atkin, who was like 5 seconds behind me.
Good
and
for
she
you,
never
Paul.
Tells this story, let me tell you that. So that's my anecdote about that.
I like it.
Jacob Fry is better than Evie Fry.
Tell us a little bit more about your relationship with Victoria, because it seems like you got on really well. There's also something about speed dating. You used to amuse yourself in between sessions by doing something called speed dating. You're looking at me like, I don't know whether I've made it
well,
up.
I don't. There's all these stories. Apparently, Victoria lived with me. I came on one thing. Apparently, we were living together. I was like, my missus isn't going to be too happy about that one.
have I got my the
I
wrong
don't
end
know,
of the stick?
Speed dating one. Is that something that Victoria's mentioned in the past, or?
No, do you know what? I'm going to be completely honest with you now. It's on your wiki entry on the Assassin's Creed thing. It says that to entertain yourself between sessions, recording sessions. You came up with stuff you made up songs and you did something.
Oh, yeah, we did make up songs.
There you go, we got there. Thank
yes.
you. Thank you, the Assassin's Creed Wiki.
Speed dating songs.
I don't know.
We had the thing called we thought Assassin's Creed would make a really good musical. And when you're in a padded cell for 4 months, 6 days a week, you kind of got to entertain yourself. You kind of go a bit stir crazy. I mean, literally, it is a box with white cushioned walls, and that's it. And we're all in leotards. It looks like something out of Marat Sade. It's like, you know, we're all just crazy people. So to keep yourself entertained, we would come up with as many musical ideas as we could. So I know what you had one.
I had one because, yeah, I was my first day of filming, I had to do every Crawford Styrock monologue on my very first day of filming. And it was just me with a bunch of, you know, other, you know, the people who were doing some of the backgroundy stuff, and I don't know, at a certain point I made the team monologue into a song, and it kind of went like this. Because I'm Crawford Starrick and I like to drink my tea. If you don't like it, you can just, I can't remember what it was, something that rhymed with tea.
He's Crawford Starrick, he stole the key, now he's going to sit back down and have a cup of tea.
Whoa, he's Crawford Starrick, he's coming for you, if you don't
sit back down and have a cup
kill
of tea.
You too.
And then we had some, because there's all the background performers, right? So it was like, I am civilian three, I am civilian three, who goes there, what's your name, I am civilian three.
And then there was also the sass, the assassin.
Sassy, oh my God.
Oh, I put the sass, the ass, and the sin in assassin. I'm the sassy assassin.
Stop
Ooh,
it.
Put that plate
Stop
away.
It.
Stop it. Stop You're pricking me.
That was good fun.
We had that, and we had the train song, which was choo choo. Here comes the train. Here comes the train. Choo choo. Every time they would set up this wood block, because they had to build the train, yeah, and it was all wooden and it's made of pipes. And they would bring it out, and all the cars would be like, choo, choo, here comes the train, here comes the train.
You got a picture,
you kind of lose
like,
your mind.
We're all monkeys wearing pajamas for like 4 months in a white box, all right? Like, you go cuckoo.
It's as fun making it as it is playing it, trust me.
Yeah.
All right, well, look, I've got a million more questions, most of which were searched on Wiki, but unfortunately I've run out of time. So a big hand, please, for Paul, Chris and Jazz. That was amazing. Thank you very much.
Thank you guys,
much.
And thank you for
and
playing the game.
And thank you most of all to Rick for playing the game.
Who That's hasn't died yet, yeah. I don't
Is this
think.
Your job?
Is this your job, Rick?
This is your job. It's what? Can you believe it? Rick's job.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
His name is Richard, thank and he's you. A very fine video game player. It's been an honor sitting beside you and watching you. I'm bummed I didn't get to see you kill me. I'd like to see you try. You just try.